Thank you so much, sir, for kind words of introduction. And last year on the same ACP meeting, I received that Early Career Physician Award by our Governor, Dr. Anand Maheshwari, sir. And then we were discussing about that COVID, that the world was shaken by the COVID, and still the sir was thinking that how we can collect the data, analyze the data, and use that data to make something that is useful for not only for the COVID, but for the post-COVID and also for the future for any viral infection. So today, I will talk about COVID diabetic registry. That is a study of factor determining the severity of patients of diabetes who develop COVID-19. So it is an original paper now accepted at Diabetic and Metabolic Syndrome Clinical Research and Reviews. And of course, we can see that Dr. Anuj Maheshwari sir and Dr. Dhruvi Asnani and myself are a part of that. Initially, we plan what's that we could plan a registry. But in a country like India, where registry is very difficult to take, and we plan that we can have a multicentric study. And our primary objective was to estimate the prevalence of newly detected diabetes in a patient who suffer from or recover from the COVID. And secondary objective was to compare the newly detected diabetes with already diagnosed diabetic patient as well as non-diabetic patient in terms of the glycemic status before and after COVID, as well as along with the disease severity. Initially, when COVID arrived, we considered that CT score was the only factor to determine the severity, but then we find out that there are many other factors that affect the severity of the diabetes. So for the methodology, we started to collect data of all the patients who are more than 18 years of old age or older, and they were RT-PCR positive, because at that time RT-PCR was considered as a gold standard for the diagnosis of COVID, and exclusion criteria were any patient who were more than 18 years of age, and duration of data was 6 months, June 2021 to November 2021. It was a multicentric study. We consider almost the pan India, and we can see that our institute was also part of that. So how the study was executed? Initially, we took 2,263 patients from the multiple centers, and then we found that 51 patients were less than 18 years of age, so we excluded them. Then we analyzed the data, and we see that there were 226 patients whose data was incomplete in terms of the comorbidities. So we exclude that data. And finally, those patients who don't have the data of blood glucose from beginning of the study and at the end of the study, that data also was excluded. And finally, 1,630 patients were analyzed. The study group definition. We started the study and we planned many things, but there was a hurdle that how to define that sample size and study. And at that point of time, we took a help of a Mediva, and the help was very well. So these three definitions are very important for this study. Who had diabetes before having COVID, and obviously they were remained diabetic after the COVID. The second group was non-diabetic, and the third group was a newly detected diabetes. The newly detected diabetes were, they were not diabetic when we started the study, and they were first time detected hyperglycemia because of many reasons. A case record form was like this. We took our demographic data, the study of COVID infections, and medical history of the patient were taken. For diabetic point of view, we took blood glucose level, HbA1c, medication used for the management of hyperglycemia, and current use of medication was also considered. For COVID related history, we took symptoms, vaccination status, need of hospitalization, date of diagnosis, management of COVID, and details about the steroid. Because in India, we found that we use almost all type of the steroids when we are treating diabetic patients and COVID patients. So we considered the name, strength, and duration, and we took them to the prednisolone equivalent so that we can uniformize the data. And for laboratory measurement, we took our C reactive protein, D-dimer, interleukin 6, neutrophil, lymphocyte, and SGPT, SGOT, and of course the HRCT score of the patient. This was our data collection sheet, and again the Mediva helped us very well. And again, at this point of time, when we have to decide what should be the sample size, what should be the statistical tool for analysis, and how the significance of data is at that point of time. Again, Mediva helped us with their expert statisticians team, and we took that 5% of the population would be a significant level, and that for that the number was 1184, and we crossed that number in our study. The steroid usage and data dosage information, the use of corticosteroid, as I already mentioned, that we use almost all the steroid during the COVID, whether it was hydrocortisone, prednisolone, methylprednisolone, deflazocort, dexamethasone, as well as betamethasone. But we divided them according to the usage of steroid as term of prednisolone equivalent. Those patients where steroid was not used, they call as a non-steroid user. When we use a 50 milligram or lesser dose, then we call them a low steroid user, and when we use 50 milligram or more, then we call as a higher use of steroids. Our study group, again, we already know that there are already established diabetes patients, there are patients who do not have diabetes, and there was a third study group, which was our main interest group, that newly detected diabetes, but they can be divided into these categories, that either they were already diabetes, but they were not diagnosed with diabetes. They may be a COVID-induced diabetes. In ADA 2022, we found the paper that the COVID virus directly invades the islet of Langerhans and reduces the beta cell production of insulin. So it can be a COVID-induced diabetes, it can be a steroid-induced diabetes, or it could be a stress-induced diabetes. That was our main purpose of study. So what were the results? In the terms of demographic and comorbidity, we can find that more patient or more aged patient were already having diabetes. 52% of the average age of our patient who already had diabetes, while 45 and 50 years of the age was in non-diabetes as well as newly detected diabetes. And on the other side, we can say that in non-diabetic patient, 60% patient do not have any major comorbidities, and 34% of the patient who had a newly detected diabetes do not have any other comorbidities, while in diabetic known patients, that is a comorbidities and majors are hypertension, dyslipidemia, obesity and hypothyroidism. Talking in terms of our symptoms, we can see that diabetic who had already had diabetic were more symptomatic as compared to the non-diabetic as well as patient who newly detected as with diabetes, but the number was not statistically significant. Now again, this chart is very important. It shows that blue is a already diabetic population, green is a newly detected diabetes, and orange are the population who were non-diabetic. In terms of RBS, at the admission, the non-diabetic has a higher RBS. In terms of HbA1c also, the already non-diabetic has a higher HbA1c. But talking about the HRCT severity, the patient who first time detected diabetic during the study were have more HRCT value. Now comparison study for other surrogate marker, we can say that patient who were newly detected with diabetes has a more percentage of hospitalization, more percentage of stay to hospitalization, as well as their oxygen requirement and steroid requirements were higher as compared to the other population. So question that arise after the study, that even the known case of diabetes were not having more complication. They were, of course, they were more symptomatic, but their hospitalization, their oxygen requirement and the steroid requirement was not more. While the newly detected diabetes has a more requirement, what are the factors that can contribute? The possible factors are age, gender, comorbidity, steroids, number of vaccination dosage, and the brand of the vaccine available. So on further exploration, we find that diabetic patients were more symptomatic, but they developed less complication, and newly detected diabetes who were less symptomatic, but developed more complication. So to conclude, we can say that for non-diabetic group, they were having lesser severity on the HRCT, their age was higher, still they developed less complication. While the newly detected diabetic patient, they have a higher HRCT value at the diagnosis and they develop more complication. So what is the message here? The message here is that we are living in a country in India where we have a very large population who are undiagnosed with diabetes. We have too much population with pre-diabetes, and those, if they were not screened properly and treated properly, if any pandemic like this occurs again, and then we have more population at risk. And our limitation of this study was it was a lockdown era, so we use EHR and telephonic consultation of the patient for further data collection. And it was unclear that pre-existing diabetic we can apprehend because of the COVID admission, or they develop stress-induced hyperglycemia or steroid-induced hyperglycemia. And the scope of further research, of course, this study enlightened very much scope for many studies, whether this newly detected diabetic were reverted to the normal diabetic or not, how their clinician approached them, and whether lifestyle intervention and other medicine can reverse or prevent these comorbidities. My acknowledgement for ACIP India Capture to SEPPER for supporting this study, as well as Mediva for providing all the electronic and statistical background. With that, I would like to thank you, my colleague and my partner, Dr. Dhruvi, and this is our institute. Thank you so much.